The idea to make a movie called Howard and the Shed came to me as a result of a movie called Assault on Precinct 13, which was made by a brilliant man named John Carpenter. I distributed that movie and took it to London, where it received the first prize in the London Film Festival. So I knew I had to make a movie with John, and I racked my brain. And one night on an airplane coming back from Italy, I thought about making a horror film, because it would be marketable movie, and I wanted to make it in one night because it could control the budget. And boom, Halloween popped into my head. I thought that Halloween had been done before, but it turned out it never had been, and nor had the name ever been used in a movie before. That's quite amazing. And then I thought, let's terrorize some kids on how babysitters. Everybody's been a babysitter or had a babysitter or was a baby, you know, so. I thought that would be a good coming on. So the point I make here is that the two ideas were synonymous. They really came at the same time. When I got off the plane, I ran home, I told my wife what I thought about it, and she said, "Oh, that's exciting. Call John Carpenter right now." It was late, it was about 9:10 o'clock in the evening. I got John on the phone, I described what I wanted to do. He got it instantly. He got very excited. I said, "Let's meet the next morning, let's talk about this." The next morning, and as he said, I don't remember this, but he said, over a tuna fish sandwich, we discussed how to make the movie, and I said, I wanted this to be Hitchcockian. I wanted it to be more like, I used the examples of Exorcist and Psycho, because each of those films showed very little. It was all imagination. It was called theater of the mind, because when I was a kid, we had radio, we didn't even have television. He understood perfectly. John just agreed to everything we talked about. He got me so excited. Oh, in those days, I think it would have been a movie about this microphone. He was the hungry young filmmaker. And then he said, "I want my name above the title." And I thought that was so audacious, you know. He made one movie, and now he wanted to live with it. I said, "Can you do this movie for $300,000? He said, "Yeah, I can do that." I said, "Well, you can have your name above the title. You can have anything you want." That's how it all started.
And so then John roped in some of his cohorts, Dean, Nick, Tommy, talk about when the... we have more coming. Talk about when John and Deborah first approached you guys with this idea. Did they already have a script written, or you guys brought it even before that one?
Well, I had done... probably about a dozen local, pardon me, Mike, I had done about a dozen low-budget driving theater movies, there's been a script supervisor on the show. Her name was Deborah Hill, and I worked with her on about four different movies. She always impressed me because not only was she taking notes and stuff, every now and then she'd come up and say, "You know, it seems to me like," and, you know, some story form or whatever. So she was obviously more interested in film than just a job. And then one day I got a phone call from Deborah, and she said, "You know, there's this guy, and we're going to make this movie, and his name is John Carpenter. I think you guys would make a good team. Why don't you meet him?" And so I did. And apparently they thought it was okay to hire me, so I'm working on the movie.
Hello, are you here?
Yes.
Well, as some of you probably already know, John and I go back to childhood together. Think grade school, played the orchestra, the whole deal, and we got very close as teenagers.
Trick or treating?
No.
No.
Not with John.
Did you babysit?
No.
You did?
Anyway, we played music together, and that was really the basis of our friendship, was making music and loving the Beatles and stuff like that. And then John, who knew what he wanted to do, film directing since age 9. I didn't know what a film director was or that such a thing existed. Is there any other?
Bowling Green?
Bowling Green, Kentucky. Anyway, I helped him. I took him up to the college library. They had this big blue book of colleges. He focused on New York University, Florida, the Simba School at the University of Florida, and USC. And USC won out, and he headed off. And then after I graduated from art school in Ohio, I headed out west to join up with him. And so Halloween was his third feature. The first one was kind of a student film that got out of control. The second one was a legitimate feature with a schedule and a budget, 35mm. We really thought we were grown-ups at that point. And Irwin was involved completely in assault and thought of the title. Irwin's a good man with the title, as you now know. And so when Halloween came along, John loved working with friends, and so he turned to me and asked me if I could design a movie, art direct and design a movie. And I said, oh, yeah, sure. Well, the less you know, the more confident you can be in your answer. And so I just shrugged my shoulders and said, yeah, and kind of learned on the job. But that's how I got.
My job on the show was limited to, as you know, the running around in a rubber mask. So,
how do you know him?
But okay, yeah, that's what I'm going to get to.
Oh, okay.
But like Tommy, I knew John before his career took off, but not as far back as him. I grew up in Los Angeles and met him when we were all at the University of Southern California. We did shorts together, had a lot of fun, we sang together, had vanity. Rock and roll groups, always, that was really our first love, basically. And, but when John started to do his movies, you know, I would go back, and the first one, Dark Star, which was started off as a short at film school. I worked in the background of those movies, that movie. Then when he made it into a feature, I went and helped him and Dan O'Bannon work on that. And then went off, to try to do my own movies.
I want to interject that Nick, those who know Dark Star, remember the beach ball alien creature. Nick played the feet of the beach ball. And I, to be honest with you, I think that John looked upon him as kind of his lucky charm, and so naturally turned to him to play the immortal part of the shape in Halloween.
That came about because they were really shooting this. Part of where they were shooting was in Hollywood, which was a couple miles or less from where I live. And I said, you know what? It's going to be so convenient for me to be on this set, watch you shoot, watch the crew. I want to be a director. Let me hang around. He said, okay, put the mask on and you'll be here the whole time. So some things are done, with all kinds of creative reasons in mind. Some things are just done out of luck, and that's why I'm here 40 years later.